I know we've all been missing our next guest. Well, we found her. Welcome to Dog Show Tips, Ms. Virginia Line. Brought to you by Canine Chronicle TV and ProPlan Nutrition That Performs.
Hello, everyone. Today we have a special guest of honor is Ginny Line. Hi, Ginny. How are you?
I am well, thank you, Will. Pleased to be here.
Well, it's good to see you. Everybody misses you.
Well, I'm missing it, too.
I'm sure. All right, let's get right into it. Tell me how you first got involved in dogs, Ginny.
Oh, my God. We have to go back to the dark ages. Family always had dogs, not show dogs, but always had, well, it was the traditional Cocker Spaniel. We went with party color, and in the old days in Texas, we had what was called a platinum blonde. It was the attempt when they were trying to breed an almost white American Cocker Spaniel. And they were working on this very, very pale platinum. We had one of those. And we had a dachshund for a while in Colombia. It's in different places, wherever family was, we had a dog. Then when my father retired and we ended up in Victoria, the decision was that as soon as he found a house, I had a dog. So that took us down to what was called in Victoria a parlor match or a parlor show. Not a sanctioned match, it was a parlor show. And we met a woman there who lived up the island of Peace, and she had a litter of black American Cockers, two of them, two males. And of course, I came home with one, and the next thing I was doing obedience, and I had to do obedience because he was one of those. His name was El Toro, the bull, and he definitely had some of those qualities. So we had to go to obedience training, and I ended up becoming very involved in obedience, taught it for nearly 20 years, taught obedience classes.
Can I interrupt just for a second? How old were you when you started in, not with just dog, owning dogs, when you first started, say, obedience or a
dog? Doing this? I was 13.
And explain to me, I hate to back you up, but explain to everybody why you were in Texas and Colombia.
All these different places? Well, it was Texas, Colombia, Trinidad, finished up in Colombia. And I was born in Borneo. So my father, I was one of the wild dyaks of Borneo, you know, the one that were the headhunters. and my dad was a oil engineer for Shell Oil. So he was in the oil camps and he was the camp superintendent in Colombia and very large oil field that was there. So.
I just wanted
that
to.
That was how we moved around.
Mm-hmm. Needed to fill in that blank because I didn't know why you were there either. So.
Yeah. All right. Well, we had time in Texas, and we had, you know, wherever he was. He worked for Royal Dutch Shell, which was centered in The Hague in Netherlands. But
you
moved around a lot.
Okay, sorry to interrupt. I can fast forward back up to your black Cocker Spaniels.
Back up to the black Cocker Spaniel, El Toro. And at that point, then I played with him. We showed him, and never did finish him, but we showed him and became very involved in the obedience and did a lot of obedient stuff. And I liked, I enjoyed that. It was the days of Blanche Saunders obedience, you know, with the choke chain and the whole bit. Not the way it's done nowadays. And then I went to England, and four of us out of university went to England, supposedly for about 3 or 4 months. And I ended up deciding I was going to stay, and I went and stayed with relatives and lived in just outside of London for close to a year. Ended up running out of money, so I had to teach. So I taught high school for what was called then a secondary modern, and taught there and earned enough money to get home. So then I brought home with me a dog from the Lochranza kennel in, that's a name that everybody should recognize. I brought home a black and white bitch from Lochranza, who was the first English Cocker that I had. Wow. From then on, I just continued to import them out of the UK, multiple different kennels. I had Lochranza, I had Weardine, I had Racklahome, I had Cochise, there was a large number of breeding pro, Sorbrook, I mustn't forget them because I did have a red out of Sorbrook for a while.
Well, so obviously English Cockers are your favorite breed.
No, you don't say that. Okay. It's the breed I have the most of, but I don't do in favorites. Will, I just don't see there being, I can have a favorite bulldog, I can have a favorite chow, I can have a favorite saluki, it doesn't matter.
But your breed of choice is English Cockers, though, it seems like.
They've given us a great deal because I had set up a breeding program and established a fairly good breeding program. Which is winding down a little bit, but right now in COVID, it's wound down totally. I have three girls this season, all dying to be bred, and can't get anybody to anybody at the moment. So that's a lost year.
They're all having that problems. So, so English Cockers. Who influenced you the most in that breed, English Cockers?
Dick Becker had a lot of influence.
He was my hero when I was a kid.
Oh, I love Dick. He was just a wonderful man. I was so sorry recently when he passed. In English Cockers, definitely Dick. We had a breeder locally that she and I bred. She brought an import dog in at the same time as I brought the Lochranza bitch in. And she had some influence on me, Pat Power, or Willowbrook English Cockers. Annie had a lot of influence in a lot of breeds, but certainly in English Cockers. The Fergusons, the Dunelms dogs out of the Carolina, North Carolina, I guess they were. And I think those were the key ones. A lot of people.
Pardon me?
There's a lot of people in England that have over the years have shared and contributed and that we are able to speak with.
Who do you figure is your most influential mentor in the sport of dogs in?
There's so many, Will, that it's really hard to say. I don't categorize them as most influential, but I would say in terms of person that I respect and learned so much from, it would have to be Annie Rogers Clark, because she just had such depth of knowledge to share and so many wonderful stories.
How did you first meet Annie?
How did I first meet her? I think I probably first met her in Westminster, and I was there, and Dottie McDonald, who was also very influential for me in sporting dogs, was there. And I have this wonderful picture of the three of us in a row. This was long after I had met Annie, but I have this wonderful photograph of the three of us sitting in a row watching the judging at the garden. I can't really think of when I actually first met Annie. We had a whippet from her in the 80s, and she mentored Kathy with whippets a lot. I visited many times at the house. She was just always in my life.
Mm-hmm. You two must have had some great conversations that I would have loved to fly and listen to you both.
I always tell the story of staying once with Annie, and I was learning a lot about both poodles and Norfolk, and we were visiting, and I was staying with her. She was having a war with squirrels the squirrels were stealing all of her food out of her feeding stations for the birds. And she was just absolutely beside herself with these bloody squirrels that were getting into the fooders. And so she had these sliding glass doors that opened onto the patio where she had the bird feeders. And she tucked behind the curtain, she had a 22 pellet gun that as soon as the squirrels came down, she just cracked the door open and put that pellet gun up to her shoulder, and boom, off went the squirrel with these little rubber bullets in his bottom, you know, and he would look down at her from the tree and you could just hear the fury in his voice. It helped for a while. It didn't solve the problem.
I saw that picture, though, as you were describing that. I saw that.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, she was a good shot, actually. She knew where she was aiming.
Who other than Annie did you have as a mentor then in the sport?
Who what?
Who other than Annie did you have as a mentor in the sport? Let's go through a few of them.
Dottie McDonald, sure. Michael Canalizo, more recently. I learned a lot. Mary Jukes, from the Whippet point of view that we have had. Good conversations with Tom Bradley. I've always loved talking.
Yeah.
Dogs with top pointers and Labradors and on with Tom. Mary Jukes, of course, for the hounds, and Michael for the hounds. I love listening to them and talking with them about those things. Dottie McDonald, Brittany's, sporting breeds generally. Those are probably, and then everybody that I judge with, because everybody that you judge with, you learn from. There's something that somebody is going to say to you, or even a question that they're going to ask you that forces you to think, okay, now why do I think that? Where did that bit of information come from? So it's a constant lineup of mentors. I mean, I want to know something from terriers, I'll go natter to David Gignac, or I'll ask a question of Michael Hill about something to do with Pekingese, or I'll, you know, there's, hey, you, I'll ask you questions, you know that.
Yeah, that's great. You know, when I was a kid, I used to, my parents started in Irish Setters, but I evolved into English Cockers, and one of the main reasons I evolved into them, because I watched at the Sportsman show, I watched Mark Webster show
Nightcap.
What was his call name?
Nightcap,
yeah. Which I loved, but until I saw...
He was the brother of Newsflash.
Until I saw Newsflash. I love Nightcap. Yeah. And when I saw Newsflash, I knew I had to have one. So.
Yeah, no, Nightcap and Newsflash were brothers. Harold Baker had Nightcap.
Yeah.
And he was best in show at one of those...
I remember.
I have the trophy. They gave it to me. And Harold and Wendy are back. They have one of our English Cockers now as a pet, who's a princess who just absolutely rules them. And but they did quite a nice little quiet breeding program. They didn't do long. He got very busy with the kids and the kid, and they had a son, and he was doing soccer, and so there were a lot of sports things involved. But Nightcap was a beautiful dog. He was a more substantial dog than Newsflash, but he didn't have quite the balance and the panache that Flash had.
Flash, I can still picture the cover. I can't remember if it was the English Cocker Memo or whatever for the English Cocker Club of America. It was a cover. You were on the cover with Flash. And I can still see the picture. And he was one of my favorites growing up. Do you have any good stories about Flash you can share with me?
Flash was a cigarette dog.
A cigarette dog?
Yeah. Not many people always understood this, but Flash had a thing about cigarette butts. And in the old days, when people still smoked around the dog show ring and could do this, and they would drop cigarette butts, he would find these and he would, in effect, point at them. He would stand and he'd bring himself up and he'd arch his neck and he'd stare at these cigarette butts. And he'd absolutely stare at them. It was like he was willing them to move. And I would pick him up by his tail both legs off the ground and swing his bottom back and forth, and he would never stop staring at the cigarette butts. The challenge was that if he saw one when we were going around the ring and it was to the right, I was on the right and he was traveling fast and ahead of me, he would spot these cigarette butts off to the right and he would dive past in front of me, trying to go as fast as I could to keep up with him. And he would stop dead and stare at the cigarette butt. So a lot of people around the ring became aware of this and they were expecting me to go head over heels. I could have multiple times. The other funny story, and this is an Annie story with Flash. When he got older, we still showed him as a veteran. He lost a couple of his premolars. So there was a little bit of a gap and it was balanced on either side. And I found that I could work with him better if he had something in his mouth to carry. So I had this tiny, tiny little mouse. It was just like minute. It had a long tail, little mouse, squeaky mouse. And he got that in his mouth and you couldn't see it. It was hidden. And I had forgotten he had it. And I took him into the ring for Annie at the National, the year she gave him the breed from the veterans class. And we went around, blah, 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 up on the table, put him up, stacked him. And Annie opened his mouth and the tail popped out the side of his mouth in the gap between his teeth. And she looked at it and she sort of looked at me and then she took the end of the tail and she gently pulled and handed it to me. She said, I think this belongs to you. So he had his mouse taken away from him. The other part was that because Annie loved the dog quite a lot and we showed him a couple of years, and at the show of shows, when he did three best in shows and best in show at the show of shows, there was Quetlaham and Annie, and I can't remember who the third judge was that was judging. By the time Annie had given him a best in show earlier that week, and we got into the show and shows on the Sunday, and he was doing his thing and he up on the table, and as Annie approached, he saw her coming and he literally threw himself at her, almost off. If I hadn't had a grip of his tail, he'd have gone off the table. He was trying to get to her. Tail was going 90 miles an hour. And as Annie sort of caught his head, she said, we're going to have to stop meeting like this. That was so Annie, you know, it really was.
That's excellent.
Those are Annie stories.
So when did you start judging? What year did you start judging, Ginny?
1968 for obedience. I judged all obedience classes starting in 68. I started sporting confirmation judging in 69. And I started with the sporting group. My very first sporting dog best in group was a pointer from Grousemore that Bill Brennan had imported. Black and white pointer, really beautiful, beautiful pointer. And I finished my old breed in 79. Wow. It was one of those, you started in a whole different way, where the approach was that you had to be interviewed. You were interviewed by judges and there were discussions with you about, how did you see such and such a breed? What did you think were the important characteristics of the Chesapeake Bay Retriever? What it was a much more in-depth process than nowadays, because you didn't have your books, you didn't have your notes, you didn't have your crib sheets. You had to sit and listen to this with this panel of three judges who were interviewing you, asking you questions about what you knew. It was always fun, but sure. You better know your stuff.
And it seems more aimed at the individual as well. So it's
absolutely.
I think as well. That was my next question. What are your thoughts on the judging process nowadays?
I had trouble getting the determination to get there as fast as possible. As soon as you have finished one little bit, you're rushing to proceed to the next little bit. I think there's a consolidation that needs to happen when you've completed. I don't like this count your numbers nonsense. I really don't. But I guess there has to be some way of evaluating how much judging. I don't think there are enough dogs being judged by a person as they are proceeding through the process. I don't think they're getting their hands on enough dogs. I think, for example, if you choose a large entry popular breed, you can get most of your required numbers, as it's called, without ever having your hands on a whole bunch of the breeds in your 13 or 14, whatever it is, breeds that you're assigned. And I'm sorry, just judging golden retrievers does not teach you how to judge black coats, and it doesn't teach you how to judge Quakehundas. I mean, it's not good enough. We've got to come up with something that will give a little more depth. And I do believe a little bit less. I personally think that we should maybe have a 6 month. You finish your permit or provisional, and it's 6 months before you can apply for more. Give yourself time to digest what you've achieved and what you've got, and hopefully go to some more dog shows. Even if you don't get assignments, go to some dog shows and watch it. But when I hear somebody say, oh, well, I don't need to do that assignment, I'm already approved, I just cringe. Education is ongoing, nonstop. You never, never stop learning stuff.
So on that same topic, what would be your advice to a new upcoming judge?
Find a really good, several really good mentors that not necessarily an all breed person, just that somebody who's if I'm starting to learn how to judge whippets, then I want somebody that is going to know sighthounds. So I would make an effort to reach out to somebody like Michael Canaliso, who is an Afghan person who has had involvement with all of the sighthounds to talk to. I would talk to somebody like Mary Jukes. I think you need to have mentors that are going to be willing to spend some time with you talking about the essence of those breeds. I think that not being in such a rush, not being so just around taking any assignment that will come your way, that's not going to teach you anything about what those dogs are supposed to be, what they're supposed to do, why they look the way they do because of their history behind them. I think also the study of the history. I think that we need to get people more aware that it's not just the breed standard, it's what created that standard that matters. Go back, look at the history, look how that breed evolved. You need to know how they work and what they functioned and what was the terrain that they had to work over, what was the purpose of them in the first place. Learn that stuff. It's not evaluated when you're learning and applying to judge, but you need to know it if you're going to do a good job.
Good question. I could listen to you all day. Keep going. Any more advice you have for us?
Oh, I think that, you know, just getting involved in I think that don't be in such a rush. You know, I know you want to get moving along so that you can start being of some use. Maybe you aspire to judging overseas or seeing dogs in different parts of the world, which is a fabulous learning experience. And you do have to have approvals for a certain number of dogs and breeds and so on to do, but try and be a little bit circumspect about how fast. I have seen too many of our Canadian judges who've been approved here to judge, say, a group going into the United States and judging that group and being unbelievably out of their depth because they've only seen two Vizslas in their entire life. And they go down there and into Minnesota and they have an entry of 65. Our judges are not ready yet to do that. They need to be a little bit circumspect about some of those situations. We approve our judges fairly easily. We don't make it that difficult for them. They have to wait a little bit. It's not very long. We don't put a huge lot of burden on them. I'm thinking of the Swedish system, which is much, much more rigorous in terms of practical exams and in-depth anatomy exams that have to be taken. We don't have anything at that level. And I think some of the Scandinavian judges come out with a much more solid foundation than our judges do. So try not to go into judging a situation. Don't go judge, 100 dogs in a breed that you've only seen two of in your lifetime.
That's for sure. And it's hard to get that through people's head nowadays, especially younger people, because it is such an instant gratification era.
Yes.
So people are just...
They want it fast. They want it now. The other thing that is important is to suck up the fact that if you want to judge dogs, you're going to have to spend some money. You're going to have to travel. You're going to have to go to Westminster. You're going to have to go to the AKC National Show. You're going to have to go to England and go to Crufts or Windsor or something of that sort. You need to realize, you need to go to the World Show and sit and look at breeds that you may not see a lot of here and sit and watch them with somebody preferably that knows something about the breed that can give you some mentoring. Go to nationals. Make an effort to go to an American national, particularly if it comes in somewhere closer to you and you don't have to spend a fortune to travel to the other side of the states. But if you've got a national coming into Washington or Oregon, then for heaven's sakes, go and sit and watch it. Even if you're approved, I don't care if you're approved. That's not the point. Exactly. You will learn so much from that.
Yeah, did you have a favorite assignment? Probably a bunch of them.
The garden.
Yeah.
The Santa Barbara Kennel Club in the old days when Ann and Tom Stevenson ran it and I judged several times for them. That was sort of where I really got to know Annie, I think probably. Thinking back to it was back in those days because Annie was always on Ann and Tom's panel. And I started to judge down there probably back in the 80s. And it was when Santa Barbara was elegant and prestigious and big entries. I did a best in show down there. And I remember putting up Bruce Schultz Greyhound Lalique with stunning. And then I went back the next year and I won the sporting group under Annie. And it was just really neat. She coached me around, now the Annie story, she coached me around the ring with that dog, trying not to let him get out of control and go too fast for her.
I think she's done that to a lot of, when she likes a dog.
Oh, she loved to do that. Yeah. It was just like, she would stop and give you a lesson right in the ring and coach you and say, all right, now, don't let him go too fast, slow down, take him here. All right, I want you over there now, go and stand in the shade.
What would it feel like when you're judging, you're center of that ring, and that dog, that special dog walks in the ring?
Well, it's what keeps us coming back to the dog game, just to have that thrill. And it is a thrill. It's a physical thrill when you reach down and put your hands on a dog and you go, oh my, look what I've got here. And I remember I was judging up in Alaska quite a few years ago, and Pat Trotter was there. And I was doing Norwegian Elkhounds. I lied, back up. I was doing Siberian Huskies this trip. And the Norwegian Elkhounds was another trip. And I had this dog come into my ring, and I thought, I don't believe this. Look at what I've got. And he had a shoulder on him, the likes of which one didn't see in Siberians in those days. And I said to him, I had finished my judging, and I said to him, wait right here, do not move. And I ran over and I grabbed Pat, who wasn't judging at the time, and I said, come with me. I said, you have to see the shoulder on this dog, because I haven't seen one like it. So we were oohing and aahing over this particular Siberian, and he turned out to be the lead dog in somebody's team. Wow. He was a racing dog, and oh my God, he was beautiful. It was the same show, actually, where I was doing American Cockers, and I had party color American Cockers come into my ring, and every single one of them, there must have been an entry of probably about 12 or 14, which up in Alaska in those days was a 5-point major. And puppy after puppy came in, ungroomed, dirty, untrimmed, ugly, worse and worse. And I thought, I can't believe this. I just can't believe this. And finally, Open Bitch comes in, and this Open Bitch has been brushed and groomed, and she was clean. She was still very, very badly constructed and a very plain common head and very ugly. And I thought, all right, girl, time to pull up your big girl panties and do something right. So I said to them, I said, I'm sorry, ladies and gentlemen, there will be no winners awarded today. There is nothing here in the ring, in my opinion, deserving of championship points today. And they all, you know, as they do, muttered and walked out. And about a half an hour later, Bill Holbrook wandered by my ring, the AKC rep. And Bill laughed and he said, hey, Jenny, what you been doing there, girl? And I said, you talking about American Caucus? He said, yeah. He said, I had somebody who wanted to crucify you. They came up to me and they said, what does that woman know about Cocker Spaniels? Bill laughed and he said, I told her. And I got home, and about 24 hours after I was in the house, the phone rang. And Michael Allen, do you know who Michael Allen was? No. Michael Allen was Bailiwick American Cockers. And she was a very artistic, very brilliant. She bred beautiful black cockers down in California. And she phoned me and she said, Jenny, darling, I love you. Thank you so much for protecting our breed from that kind of behavior. And I laughed and I said, oh, did I do it right? She said, oh, apparently the woman who came into my ring with this collection that she had loaded into her motorhome and driven from California, Pleasanton, California, up to Alaska, regularly did this, finished her, she was a puppy mill, finished her dogs up in Alaska by doing this, by taking the entire entry. And she said, we can't stop her from finishing these dogs because she goes to Alaska to do it. And she said, thank you so much. Anyhow, enough of that.
Well, I remember showing, I was helping Garrett one time, and
there's somebody I learned from.
Garrett, we all did. He was wonderful.
Yep.
And he was showing an Irish setter, a class bitch. I don't even know where she was from. And she was not very pretty. And he had tried to convince the owner not to put their money into it. But it was a client he'd had for years, so he felt obligated to try. And I'm sure it was Bill Brennan. Bill Brennan withheld ribbons on her. And Garrett stopped and thanked Bill for doing that. So now he could tell the owner.
Bill would do that.
It worked out perfectly because the the owner placed the dog and went in a different direction. And it was smart. So
Bill was a good judge. He knew his dogs.
I have one thing in my head from Bill Brennan, and it was, it's a tail, not a sail. I probably was holding the tail too high. I think he probably whacked.
There was a bit of a nasty story that Cy was aware of with Bill. That he had a woman come up to him after he had not used an English setter of his, that she showed to him in his judging, and she said to him, "Sir, I thought you would like my dog. You didn't care for her." And Bill said, "I loved your dog. I would take it home with me on the plane." And she looked and she said, but you didn't. But he said, "Then I would open the door over the top of somewhere over the Rocky Mountains and push her out." I don't think it went down very
sure.
These days he would have been up for discipline. Not in those days.
Another little story. I remember him talking, and we were discussing a dog that had done a lot of winning. And he told me, it was a gun dog. And he said, "William, they're supposed to go through the daisies, not kick the tops off the daisies."
Yeah.
Remember that story too from Bill. That's funny, the things that come back because I was speaking with you. So, what dog from the past you wish you had owned or shown yourself?
Mary White's black and tan Doberman, Farah.
Farah.
I was determined when I was in that age group there, when Farah was being shown, that this was going to be a breed. I was going to find a fantastic Doberman black and tan bitch, because I thought she was the most exquisite dog. I loved her. That was one of them.
Yeah.
I never did, of course, do that. People often ask you, what breed would you have if you didn't have what you have, you know, sort of thing. And that would have been one of them. I would love to have had, in my youth, I would love to have had a black and tan Doberman bitch and things. I would love to have owned the cream Saluki treasure of Karen Black's in California. Yeah. I don't know whether you ever saw her, but she was absolutely gloriously beautiful. I had her and Michael Canaliso's Trist together in the group ring in California, in probably the strongest hound group I think I have ever seen. Somebody counted up and said there were 14 national specialty winners in the ring at the same time. And I had Trist and Treasure, and I had went between the two back. And finally, I ended up giving Trist the group and Treasure second. And they both were very fond of each other and loved each other's dogs and so on. So they took a picture afterwards of Trist and Treasure on this hill outside on the showgrounds. And it was a spectacular picture that was taken. I don't know who the photographer was. It probably was Joan, but it was gorgeous. Anyhow, they sent me a copy of it, and Michael had written across the top, "May this be a Trist that you will always treasure."
Oh.
It's beautiful. Brought tears to my eyes, obviously.
It looks like it. Here's a tough one, too. What dog show person do you miss the most?
Annie. And Skip Stanbridge. Yeah. I really miss Skip. I learned a lot from Skip. He was a wonderful, down-to-earth, knowledgeable mentor for so many different things. So he and I judged the Brisbane Royal together. The next 4 years later, they invited me back to do the other groups that I hadn't done. And Skip was the alternate, the second judge, because they did two judges. And then they do one new sort of semi-local, either New Zealand or Australia, to do one of the groups. And I had got Skip all worked up because he had to do toys. And I said, Skip, do you realize how many short coat chihuahuas you're going to have there? There's chihuahuas coming out of the woodwork. And I said, oh my God. He said, I hate doing chihuahuas. And they're always fairly substantial ladies that have them, and they take forever to find the right dog, and then they quite often don't find the right dog to bring in. Anyhow, I got him all worked up. He was not looking forward to that experience. I said, oh, they're going to wheel up their trolleys, and they'll have all their trolleys, and in the trolleys there'll be 10 or a dozen of them, and they'll pick them up one at a time and say, no, you're not Pedro. You're Hugo. Oh, whoops, where's Felix? And, you know, trying to find the right dog.
Now, when it comes to your own breed, are there dogs that have left an impression on your mind's eye or that you would wish you had shown or owned?
I think I wish that I could have had a chance to show or own a dog called Dale Flag Lieutenant, who was, I think, one of the most beautiful headed English cockers that I ever saw. He is behind my early pedigrees. He unfortunately was a bit cowhocked, which didn't, in those days, was a little more common in the body colors than it is nowadays in English cockers. But he had a body and a rib, and I visited Sylvia Jones, his breeder, and he really did give me goosebumps.
Could you just say his name again for me? I think I may have lost it. I may have cut with
Fortdale Flag Lieutenant.
Fortdale Flag Lieutenant.
Yeah.
I recognize that name.
You should. I think also, in the current dogs, much of the stuff that the Canigou kennels, Trish Bentley's dogs, has bred. I think that some of the stuff that Angela Hackett has bred out of the UK, those are all dogs that give me great joy. I imported a dog, the Orange Roan dog, Whirlwood. Ain't No Sunshine, from Adam and April Murray. And he was one of those goosebump English cockers I loved. The funny part was I was actually at the Cocker Club National Specialty, as it is in the UK, in July. And I had been sitting watching, and I saw this dog come into the ring, and I thought, oh, that's pretty. It was an Orange Roan, and I said, this could do well in Canada, in North America. He has the look. And I think he went third out of three in the class. And I thought, okay. So I wandered over and I introduced myself to the couple. And I said, you know, this is a very handsome dog. Would you give any consideration to him possibly being able to come to Canada? And she said, oh, no, 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 no. And I sort of said, well, I think he could do well over there. And I said, it wasn't a great day here. And they said, well, oranges never win in England, you know. Then I thought, well, that's not right. Anyway, I had been sitting at the ringside still continuing. I said, you know, talk about it amongst yourselves and I'll go and continue watching the judging. So I wandered away, and a little bit later, the April came to me and she said, my husband says I owe you an apology. And I said, an apology? No, you don't owe me an apology. What for? She said, I didn't know who you were. And anyway, I got the dog. He came to live in Canada on the condition that I had him for a year with the option of a second year. And he had to go back. So he came in on a pet passport, and we maintained all his material. And I had him for 18 months. And he bred, I think it was about 15 or 16 litters. And he finished 22 or 23 American champions out of his breedings. And I have several of his progeny that are here that I love to pieces. And he was a very, very interesting dog to come, and a very beautiful. And he won the Canadian National. He never did much in the States. He was a little too Americans, but he finished. I mean, he finished easily. Michael Dackel loved him, and, you know, as he would. But he was good. Those were the key ones. I mean, I think some of the solids, newsprint, newsreader of the Lacranzas, the blacks, were very, very, the newsreader dog was a beautiful dog. I liked Bitcon Troubadour. I would have loved to have had him, Murray Armstrong's Troubadour dog, the blue dog. He was a great, great stud dog and a very, very correct cocker. Those were a few.
List. You had, no, I'm going to make that the last question. How do you think the dog show world's going to recover after COVID-19?
Oh, well, I was afraid. I don't think we're ever going to go back to what it was.
No.
I don't think there's a hope that we're going to go back to what it was. Not just COVID-19. I think we've now reached the combination of COVID-19, the combination of animal rights and their influence and control on the dog game has got to the point where we can't go back to what it was. I think we're going to have to be very, very inventive and very creative in letting in a much more, not such an elitist, it is an elitist sport. And I think we're going to have to make it a little more friendly, a lot more friendly, a lot more open, a lot more accessible to people. There's a phrase of Alley Dog Show in Vancouver, which you've been to and I love, and I know you have attended, that has a BMX event next door. And you've been there when that's been going on. And I look at that and think there's hundreds of children all in their uniforms, being supported, being encouraged, being made into little objectionable brats because of it. But they were there and their parents were there doing things with them. At the dog shows, it's people who are 50 and older who are still hanging on to the joy that they get out of showing their dogs. It's not the young people that are coming in. And if they do, they want it instant. They don't want to have to put in the apprenticeship time. They don't want to have to sit there and breed a multiple number of litters. I mean, I bred 5 litters before I kept a dog. And they don't want to do that. They want a best in show group winning dog in their first litter, their first acquisition. And I think that sense of entitlement that exists in our society and the sense that it's the now, it's not the me too, it's the me now generation that wants it immediately. And we're not going to go back to the old days when people spent years building up a breeding program and developing a line and keeping, we can't keep those numbers of dogs anymore. We're not allowed to. You know, people, there's very few people that have the option of being able to keep large numbers of dogs. And I think that animal rights is so controlling on what we can do and can't do. I think that the elitist, unfriendly atmosphere at a lot of our dog shows, we all have, you know, we get impatient with dumb questions, but we got to start being a little more patient with those people if we want to see them coming back and supporting our sport.
I agree with that.
I'm so sad. I mean, I lived through the best, and you did too. Yeah. And I would never have missed that for the world. And I'm probably, because I'm at the end of my time with doing this, I'm so glad I didn't miss that amazing time period with the dogs. And
sure did. We saw the best of them. No question. And do you have any superstitions, Jenny?
Do I have any? No, none at all. I'm totally a non-superstitious person. No. I think Kathy has one lead that she likes to use. I'm much too much a pragmatist. I you know, it's either going to be what it's going to be, and it's you know, I don't think that there's anything that I could say that I was superstitious about.
I'm going to end with this question. If you could talk to the 20-year-old Jenny Lyon, tell her what you know now, what would you say to her?
Save a little more money than you did. Stop spending it on all of your dogs and your dog shows and your travel to the dog game. Put some of it away. Same advice I would give to a young handler. Get yourself education. Get another job so that you're not dependent on just that one aspect, because it ain't going to pay your bills anymore. I think put away a bit more. I had an offer on Newsflash when I went down to Santa Barbara and won the group with him. And I got home and the phone rang after 24 hours. I was in the house and it was Ray McGinnis. You know who that was. Okay. Ray McGinnis was on the phone. Jenny, he said, I'm sitting here. I have a blank check in front of me. And I have the Bay Millers, who were English Springer fanciers and exhibitors. They want to buy Newsflash. And they will pay whatever you want. And I couldn't do it. I said, no, I can't. But I suppose if I was now, I would say, you know, for a really good price, I might have let him go, because not so much the money, is that I know that the things that the record that dog would have set, with Ray on the end of the lead and the Bay Miller money behind it, he would have had an amazing, amazing career, which I couldn't give him financially. But as far as the dogs are concerned, no, there's nothing I would change. I might have tried to buy a few more out of the UK if I could have, but not. Right now I'm sitting doing, it's fascinating, I'm doing a virtual dog show out of Spain. I don't know whether you've seen those. It's called Global Dog Game 2020. They have 3,900 dogs entered. I'm doing English Cockers, Whippets, Corgis, and some things like Chesapeakes and Curly Coats, Fields, Quakehundas. And then I do the group for the Spaniel, Group 8. I have an entry of 258 dogs with those breeds. The English Cocker entry, I have 31 open dogs, 28 open bitches. And there's only three classes in the show. There's junior, open, and veteran. And will the quality, I'm just reveling in this quality of dogs that I'm getting to judge. I have to place those large classes down to 15. I have to place 15 of them.
Oh my.
And then I write critiques on the best breed and best opposite in juniors, open, and veteran. The photographs, you get a side picture, a head picture, and a moving picture. Some of them are better than others. Sure. You know, some of them are well photoshopped. You could read those, but oh my God, there's some beautiful English cockers. I don't know what I'm going to do. They're just spectacular. So, you know, one of your questions I think you could have asked me was, what am I doing? And that's what I'm doing. I'm working on that.
I overlooked that question. I do.
And during COVID, I am, one, I'm cooking. Two, I'm doing every one of the seminars from the AKC webinars. So from 10 o'clock to 11:30, nobody interferes with me. I'm watching whatever breed is being. Today it was Golden Retrievers. And I watched, and I have judged the national for that breed in the States 4 times. But I watched the webinar. And I don't know, I learned anything new that I didn't know, but it was interesting. And I've learned some fascinating bits of history. If you get an opportunity, watch the Keukehunder one. It is fascinating what they have done in showing the history of this breed and how it was used and how it works. And the work that dog, little dog, does is fascinating. So I'm doing that.
Quick Cole's notes of what they do.
No, well, they have these, they run a banks, they have fencing that makes a tunnel, and the geese or the ducks, usually the ducks, are on the river. And these dogs run alongside the river and they steer these ducks into a hole, a channel, where at the other end they're captured by the hunter. And they can't get out because they've got these fences along the side of this. It's like a big ditch. Mm-hmm. And they've got these geese corralled on by these fences. And these little dogs are running and they go in and out of the fence. The dogs, there's gaps in the fence where the dogs go in and they pop up further down and they chase. It's very similar to the behavior in a lot of ways of our tollers.
Sure, sounds like, yeah.
You know, they have the little tail up in the air. There's a little bit of, they're quieter, they don't bark, but they do this this darting movement, which the geese get attracted to, and they pop up ahead of them, and the geese are saying, oh, look, and you can see them chasing them down to the hole. It's fascinating.
Yeah, that'd be fun to watch.
Yeah, you should. I don't know how to tell you to do it, but it's on the those webinars. You can sign up for them.
Like, I will. I'll look into that. Well, I'm glad you did that and brought that back up because I overlooked that question. Do you have any final?
I'm doing with my time. I'm studying breeds. I'm learning. And every now and then I have to go and let a dog out or you know, feed somebody or, you know, tell the Pekingese to be quiet. You knew we had a Pekingese now.
Yeah. Tell me that.
Pekingese to be quiet. He's become the palace guard. He's now definitely the palace guard and the least noise. He says, I'm in charge here. Don't you dare. Sitting over there to my right.
Are you going to show him? I think you have shown him, haven't you?
He's shown. I don't know what Kathy's planning at the moment. No, she's got, who knows what we're going to do with dog shows? We've got a whippet that we're just sitting, waiting to show. And I've got 2 cocker puppies that should have been out being shown, but they're going to miss their puppy life. They're going to be out of puppy class by the time we get back to dog shows. But I'm not, you know, there's no point getting into a knot about it. And I think that's probably, you know, nobody ever saw this coming. And with dog shows having gone the way they are, this is why I think more than anything, I hope parents are saying to their young handlers who have aspirations of being a big time handler, get yourself an education, kid, go to school, have a backup.
A backup plan. Always have a
backup. Do something that you can do. You know, I have such respect for those handlers who made themselves another life now during COVID in order to, you are doing what you're doing. I see Allison doing what she's doing. I see David doing what he's doing. I just am so impressed with the people that have been able to put together another life that, that's enabled them to go on without dog shows.
Well, I hope dog shows come back because I truly miss
them. I hope they do. I don't want to see us not, but it's going to come back in a different form because we're going to have this virus in our lives, I think, for several years. I don't think we're ever going to get away from it totally. I don't think I couldn't judge dogs in a mask, and yet that may be what it will come to.
That would be very difficult.
Even the breathing is going to be very difficult. If you wear glasses, it's even worse because you fog up your glasses.
I was just in Home Depot.
I mean, outdoor dog shows, how are the handlers going to run in a mask?
You're not going to be able to breathe.
You can't breathe. And it's all very well to say, okay, you can judge certain breeds like boxers and dobes and so on, sort of Fila fashion, as you do for the Fila de Brasilia. But you can't do that with a Pekingese. You can't judge a Maltese that way. You can't judge a Shih Tzu that way. And there's no way that head-to-head, you can't separate the owner handling the dog and the judge examining the dog from a satisfactory distance. You can't do it.
Very difficult, yeah. Putting both at risk and the dog, as far as I'm concerned.
Everything is being put at risk. And a lot of our judges are in that vulnerable age group, you know, that I wouldn't want to be the first one that sees somebody get sick because a handler had to come to the dog show or an exhibitor had to come to the dog show and they were sick and they shouldn't have been there.
And you know they will. If you would build it, they'll come.
Will, absolutely. I mean, I've seen them come into the ring with streaming colds and flus in the winter and they're just sharing it around. But that doesn't kill somebody. This one can kill somebody.
Yeah. We have to change the note. We can't end on this note, Jenny.
I'm sorry. It's just, you know, I think we need to wipe out dog shows for 2020 and hope that there's something that can come good in 2021 and that everybody will be so happy to be there. They'll be nice to each other and they'll be nice to the judges and they'll be nice to the dogs.
Yeah, that's enough, Pete. A good reset button is what we all need. So.
I think so. And this is our reset for society.
I think you're right.
This is our reset for society. We've got, I mean, you look at climate change. This is our indicator of a reset. There are definitely some changes that have been.
No question. Look at the aerial photographs. There's no question.
Yeah. It's fascinating to see how this has changed.
Even wildlife, even around here, I see more because there's just less going on. So they're sort of coming back.
They're coming into the residential areas around here. We're getting bear and deer and you know, all sorts of things coming in. Yeah. Anyway, it's been lovely talking to you.
It's been great talking to you. I miss seeing you. And I know everybody else misses seeing you. I kept hearing that, but they all missed you. It was great. Thank you for sharing your time with us.
Thank you, Will.
And Kathy, my love.
You stay safe.
I will.
Bye-bye.
Well, you knew Miss Lyon wasn't going to let us down. Thank you for inviting us into your home. Well, if you like what we're doing here, please be sure to press like, share, and subscribe, and that little notification bell. And if you need to get a hold of me, dogshowtips@gmail.com, or you can go right to my website, willalexander.net. Ciao for now, guys. Thanks.